Right. So first of all, a warm welcome to all of you for this session on current affairs. The first part of the lecture will be about how important current affairs is. The second part will be on what is the trend in the UPSC prelims examination as far as current affairs is concerned. And the third part is on certain topics which we will discuss, which came in the newspaper from November 1st to November 15. So last 15 days, you have certain issues or certain important facts, issues of importance as far as UPSC examination is concerned, which has come in the last 15 days, and we'll handpick some issues we'll discuss, right? So coming to the first part, current affairs becomes important in the recent times, especially when you see the trend of UPSC in 2011 and compare it with 2018 and 19. In 2011, the number of questions in current affairs were minimal. There were no adequate number of questions from current affairs. Most of the questions were coming from the conventional areas. So if you could study conventional areas very thoroughly, then there is a very fair chance for us to get selected in the prelims examination. So current affairs was not having that much of weightage till 2011, if you see. But when you go back from 2002 to 2011, or 2002 to 2012, 2012 to 2019, we would see that the number of questions from current affairs were more in the period from 2002 to 2012 or 2002 to 2010. The number of questions in current affairs started increasing. 2004, 2005, 2006 and all, the number of questions from current affairs were so significant. Those days, the number of questions in total prelims GS will be 150 questions, out of which 30 questions to 40 questions will come from current affairs. But in 2007, 2008, you can see a dip in the number of questions from current affairs as the question got oriented towards more of general knowledge. They started asking GK questions. Earlier, it was current affairs from 2004, 2005, 2006, it was current affairs. After say 5 years, they started 3-4 years, they started asking questions which are very static in nature. For example, they would ask you certain facts. It is not so current, but it is a very important fact which you have to know about the country. So it became very factual, and it was not current affairs, it became what? It became general knowledge. It became general knowledge. 2011-12, the number of questions asked in current affairs started reducing. 2015-16, it started picking up. And in 2017-18, the number of questions were so high. And we could see that when you take current affairs as a separate subject, the number of questions asked in current affairs is more than the number of questions asked in any single conventional area. So you put the number of questions which comes from Indian polity, Indian history, and you weigh in the measuring balance, current affairs will be having more weightage than these two heavyweights. Normally, a student preparing for this examination will think that if he covers, she covers Indian polity, if she covers or she covers history, and if they could cover some aspects of geography, then UPSC preparation is over. You should understand that close to 30 to 40% of the question, 30 to 40 questions are coming from current affairs. So without covering this 30 to 40% of the question, no preparation will be comprehensive. If you miss out the current affairs area, you go to prelims, you are only writing the test for 60 questions, leaving out 40 questions. But the difficulty in preparing for current affairs is this: when you have a definite book, when you have a definite syllabus, when things are very, very crystal clear regarding what you have to study in Indian polity, what you have to study in history, what you have to study in geography. Unlike the solid areas of conventional topics, current topics are very, very fluid areas. Very fluid. It cannot be, you know, solidified. It becomes very difficult to make this fluid a solid. Because if you read Hindu newspaper, they'll ask from Indian Express. If you read Indian Express, they'll ask from Lime Mint. If you, everyone knows that PIB is becoming a very important source of question, next time they may not ask in from PIB. So, UPSC knows the pulse of the students. And to clear this examination, we have to know the pulse of UPSC. Because the intention of UPSC is to reject us. Therefore, they wanted to know our pulse. The intention of us is to clear examination. So, we have to know the pulse of UPSC. And here where we have to become very smart enough. That our preparation for current affairs will have to be very, very comprehensive. If a single student is preparing for current affairs, there are some 8 to 9 sources which are very, very important from current affairs point of view. But a single person cannot comprehend all these things. And here becomes necessary, or here comes the role of the institution or the teachers who can make the fluid things solid. So, the attempt of this current affairs class is to make a fluid current affairs as a solid current affairs. So, solidifying the fluid current affair is what is the primary objective of this class. What class is going to give to you? We have to analyze all the important areas which are coming in the news. In fact, you have to be like a swan. You have to separate the milk from the water. You know, newspaper is not written for only aspirant community. Newspaper is written for the general population. So, you have to be very selective in selecting only those aspects of news which is important from UPSC point of view. Reject the water, which is very political in nature. So, here where filtering of the newspaper becomes very crucial. And this class will filter the newspaper, give you what is required for UPSC examination. We also have to know how we are going to go ahead for the next 5 to 6 months. Because the class starts now, it is going to go till April. Right? So, this class will be every Thursday you will have the class if you wanted to join the regular batch. Or every Saturday you have this class if you wanted to join the weekend batch. So, we have this idea. First class will be over. Then in the next class, what you have taught, what you have been taught in the first class will be asked as questions. So, this will ensure that there is no passive learning taking place in the class. You are very much conscious that the topics which are discussed in the class will be asked as a question in the next week test. So, therefore, it becomes an active learning rather than passive learning. So, involvement of you will increase if you come to know that this will become a question next week. There will be a test which will come along with the class. So, first half an hour there will be a test and subsequently we will start the class. Right? So, this will be the routine of every current affairs class, excepting the first class. From the second class onwards, you have half an hour test on some 20 to 30 questions based on the number of topics covered in the class. In the next week, it will come as a test. Then we also will give you the soft copy of the current affairs update. It will be given in the monthly basis so that it will be consolidating your current affairs preparation. Right? So, this is what the beginning of this current affairs. We will like to get into some aspects of the questions which they have asked in the previous year to get a feel of the UPSC expectation. So, I will give you some questions which they have asked in the years 2018 and 2019 to get a glimpse of what UPSC is expecting Therefore, you will be able to prepare according to the demand of this UPSC. Just a minute. First of all, we will see the previous question. Just a few sample questions we will see, because if we take every question, then it becomes very difficult for us to do the topics. To give you a glance of UPSC previous year question, I have put some questions from the past papers of UPSC. Just we'll have a glimpse of that before we start the topics. I've told you about the trend. Look at the major segment of this question of prelims will be current affairs. 30 to 40 questions on an average. 30 to 40 questions will be asked from current affairs. Right? Look at this. 2019, the number of questions can range from, the number of questions will range from 30 to 35. So, one third of your prelims question will come from current affairs. Therefore, you should be extremely strong to tackle these questions. So, look at the average number of questions may increase or decrease, but constantly increasing questions will be current affairs. The number of questions which they asked from current affairs in 2011 was just 5 questions. And look at how it fell in 2013, because in 2013 there were 1 or 2 questions. If somebody says there is only 0 number of questions asked in 2013, but it started picking up from 2013, and you can see that it crossed 35 questions in the year 16. And slightly it is having its dip in 2017-18, but compared to all other subjects, still current affairs is becoming a very important component in your prelims examination. And when it comes to main examination, paper 2, paper 3 is full of current affairs. So I would say in the GS, out of 1000 marks in GS mains, 500 marks you can score by reading current affairs properly, because second paper and third paper will be fully loaded with current affairs substance. We will discuss some sample questions of the previous years, and this question was asked in 17. So why this question was asked? Because global climate change is a very, very important issue which is bothering all the nations of the world. Right from 2008, global warming becomes a very, very important topic to be discussed in all the international platforms, and even the financial institutions like World Bank is stipulating a condition that only when you are going for a green project, I will give you the assistance, otherwise don't come to me, I will not give you any loan for your power project. So various institutions which are non-environment are becoming environmental, so cutting across the purpose of the formation of the institution, almost all the global institutions have become green, talking about more and more the threats which may emerge because of global warming. So now that you should know, climate related questions are very, very important. Climate related questions are very important. Right? Environment related questions are very, very important. So, global warming, sometime they asked about the ozone depleting substances and Paris Agreement, Kyoto Protocol, carbon credit system. All these were already asked. Non-annex countries according to Kyoto Protocol. So, many questions centering around the climate change topic is very important. Any question related to any issue related to climate change, if it comes in the newspaper, see that very carefully, because questions are likely going to come from that area. So, a simple question was asked. Global Climate Change Alliance And this becomes a very important trend which you have to know. Major climate related initiatives of the international or the regional groupings becomes a very important UPSC question. Climate related innovations, climate related alliances, climate related cooperations in the international institutions and in the regional grouping becomes very important. So they asked, global climate change alliance is related to what? Which organization? Any idea? Global climate change alliance is related to which organization? Which organization? Any idea? It is related to a particular organization. You tell me which organization. I'll give you these statements. Is it an initiative of European Union? You tell me whether it is an initiative of European Union. No idea. It provides technical and financial support to the targeted developing countries to integrate climate change into their development policies and budgets. So the second statement is a very, very commonsensical statement. Definitely any alliance will have to give what? Financial support and technical support. So second statement, even without reading, you have no problem related to technical financial support, but definitely you have a problem related to whether it is developing country or not. But here also you can use your common sense that the developed country can take care of itself. Only the developing country and the least developed countries wanted the assistance from others. This common sense we can use. The developed country will take care of itself. America will not come with a begging bowl asking money from any other country because America is a developed country. But that financial might is not available for other countries, which is why developing countries will definitely expect a partnership with a grouping so that they can get financial assistance and the technical assistance from the organization. But we are not able to decide on whether it is an initiative of European Union or not. It is coordinated by World Resources Institute and World Business Council for Sustainable Development. Here also we are not having any clue because they have given something which is very, very precise. So this is very general statement, and therefore we can use our common sense. If they give you a specific statement, then definitely without knowing the answer, you cannot proceed. And you should understand that not many articles came on this. Once it came, then disappeared. So when everybody will study only the frequently coming topics in the newspaper, sometimes once it comes in the newspaper, or sometimes it will not be coming in the newspaper at all, but still UPSC will lift this. So should I go to each and every organization's website to check whether you have any initiative related to climate change? And that is humanly not possible. But you should know that most of the time UPSC will ask a frequently coming news but with a different dimension, or infrequently coming news but which is very, very important for environment. So a frequently coming news from a different dimension, number two, infrequent news but which is very, very relevant for the situation, current situation. So the choices given are like this: 1 and 2 only, 3 only, 2 and 3 only, 1, 2, 3. Any idea which you have? Any idea? European Union has taken this initiative. So 2007, it is an initiative of European Union. When it was asked? 17 it was asked. Maybe after 10 years they wanted to take stock of how this alliance performed in the last 10 years. So here you have a clue. if some cooperation, some initiative has crossed a particular period of time, say 10th anniversary or 20th anniversary or 50th anniversary, based on that, questions can be lifted. After 10 years, what this alliance really did to the least developed countries, what this alliance did for the small island developing countries, SIDs. So it came, once it came in the newspaper. What this alliance, is it, was it useful? Because in 10 years of its functioning, you will come to know whether it is useful or not. So definitely, due to the 10th year, it came in the news, and the answer is all. Now come to this National Investment and Infrastructure Fund, right? It is an organ of Niti Aayog. Everybody sees in the newspaper many, many initiatives of Niti Aayog. So we come to a conclusion that this also should be an initiative of Niti Aayog, but actually it is not an initiative of Niti Aayog. It has a corpus of 4 lakh crore at present. Normally, our assumption is that, our expectation, and our assumption is that, because we assume as per our expectation, our assumption and expectation is that UPSC should not trouble you with the numbers. UPSC troubled us. Everybody knows that 4 will come first and some zeros also will come, but preciseness they don't know. Some students, they read this as 40,000 crore and they said this statement is a right statement without properly counting the number of zeros. Actually, the fact is 40,000 crore, but what they have given is 4 lakh crore. So, if you study something like 40,000 and you see in the question paper, you have in your mind 40,000, you read only 40,000 even though it is given 4 lakhs. This is a very, very potential number, and many have slipped because of this. 40,000 instead of 40,000, it is 4 lakh. And if we have a common sense that what is the annual budget of the union, what is the annual budget of the union? 27 lakh crore. 27 lakh crore is the outlay of the total government, union government's budget. And how can you allocate 4 lakh crore for only one simple thing like National Investment Fund? So, here where we will be misguided, that instead of 4 lakh, we will read 40,000. When number comes, therefore, in the newspaper, you have to precisely know, because this question can be answered only if you know precisely what is what. So, in the last two questions, we have seen that without preciseness, it is not possible for us to make those questions right. Precise answer should be given. So, definitely, both are wrong. So, neither one nor two. Now, come to Global Infrastructure Facility. See, environment related, infrastructure related facility is very much important. Who had initiated that is very important. Global Infrastructure Facility is initiated, was initiated by whom? Global Infrastructure Facility, any idea? Global Infrastructure Facility, World Bank. If you know that this is World Bank, directly go to the statement which has World Bank, you need not know all these things. So, at the macroscopic level, if you study some questions, you can make it right. Some questions require you to go down to the microscopic level. Soil Health Card Scheme. You know that during the UPA government itself, when UPA government was in place, they wanted to introduce the soil health card to the farmers. So they kick-started this process of issuing soil health card. Right? So around 2007 this scheme started, but they could not do that very properly because of lack of staffs, because of lack of soil testing labs, and therefore they have given only 50 lakh soil health cards. BJP government came to power in 2014. They wanted to take this in a very big way, and therefore in 2015 they launched the scheme, and they told that 14 crore farmers will be given soil health cards. So this scheme was already initiated by UPA in 2006-07, but in 2015 only this was revamped. The coverage earlier was just 50 lakh and now it is 14 crore, out of which 6 crore farmers were given soil health cards. Now soil health card, this you need to know whether the aim of this is to expand the cultivable area under irrigation, because something is related to soil, so it has to increase the area under cultivation. Whether it is to enable bank access, enabling the banks to assess the quantum of loans which can be granted to the farmers based on the soil quality. If my soil is good, then I can go to a bank can give me loan easily, whether it is for that, or it should be checking the overuse of fertilizers in the farmlands. Now the choice is 1 and 2 only, 3 only, 2 and 3 only, and 1, 2, 3. Remember, since the days of Green Revolution, we had the problem of overuse of chemicals, and that resulted in the deterioration of the soil. So the health of the soil was severely damaged because of what? Because of overuse of chemicals. Green Revolution, we wanted to increase the production, we wanted to increase the productivity, but at the same time, in the name of productivity and production, we spoiled the health of the soil. So therefore, this scheme is mainly intending to do this, checking the overuse of fertilizers in the farmlands. Common sense tells that if you can enrich the soil, if you make the soil very nutritious, if you could make the soil, if you could maintain the health of the soil, definitely this will happen. Definitely this will happen. If you apply common sense, these two things will happen. But actually it says, what is the aim? What is the purpose? The purpose is three. The purpose of the scheme is not one and two. So when you have a broader reading, we will not be able to understand this nuance present in the question. When you read a scheme, first of all you should read what is the aim of the scheme. That has to be very clearly known to you. Aim of the scheme will have to be clearly known to you. Target of the scheme will have to be known to you. Outlay of the scheme will have to be known to you. Right? So aim, target, outlay. Target means what is the year which we have assigned, which will be the year of achievement of the goal which we are setting, when we will achieve. So they will give you a target year for every scheme. This is how we have to be very precise in knowing the schemes. Now look at this. Controversial chemicals found in the commonly used materials. Lipstick, lead, soft drinks, brominated vegetable oil, and Chinese food, monosodium glutamate, because MSG content was more in the noodles. Definitely we know that MSG content was more in the noodles. So these are the commonly present chemicals, unwanted chemicals, and these are the products. So whether the pair is rightly matched or not, this definitely needs to be known by all, not only an IAS aspirant. Everybody using all these things will have to know what is present in what. So this is, this lead present in lipstick, any idea? Brominated vegetable oil present in soft drink, and monosodium glutamate present in Chinese food, everybody knows. So the choice is 1 only, 2 and 3 only, 3 only, 1, 2, 3. We know 3 is correct. So if 3 is correct, A will not come, but the problem is 1 should not, A will not come because it is not having 3, others are having 3. So you should know all the 3 statements. Sometimes you will be very lucky that you say that one statement is not going to come, you directly go to the answer, you are right, because by elimination technique, there will be only one answer. Even without knowing the other statements, you will be able to make the right answer. And that you have to be lucky enough. But don't go to UPSC with this factor in your mind that luck will favor us, work only will favor us, luck will not favor us. Answer is what? Answer is all the above, correctly matched. This is psychologically disturbing us. This is a question not in CSAT English comprehension, but in GS prelims. A student seeing this will go to the next question. He will have a withdrawal symptom. This is called as withdrawal symptom. It will not work. Because, see, we even go to the extent of going into the motive of the question setter. What is the motive of him? Right? What sort of person? What sort of person he is to put this question? But when you read, you get the answer in the first few lines. What is this? Using your smartphone, you can switch on, you can switch off, all these things you can do. What should I do? Because if I click, then it may go. So what is this? The choice is this. One line they can write now. Smartphone rings, you wake up, story they are telling you. They are writing the story. What are the things which we are doing daily, that they are telling. AC will be on, fans can be on, AC can be switched off, you can lock the door. Why should you narrate like this? Just to tell you that you have to have some sort of patience when you prepare for this examination. Wait. So this is telling you wait. What is the answer? Is it called border gateway protocol, or internet of things, or internet protocol, or virtual private network? Internet of things. So a very simple question. Merchant discount rate is what? What do you mean by merchant discount rate? The service provider will be given some commission by the bank when the transaction is done. I am swiping the card. So because of that, there is a service provider who is linking me with that of the bank. The service provider, like Visa, will charge some amount from the bank. So 100 rupees will go to bank. I am swiping 100 rupees, it goes to the bank. And that transaction is made possible because of this mediator called Visa. And the bank will have to give some money to this service provider or not. And that is called as merchant discount rate. But if you do not know that, if you go only by the terminology given in the question, it will definitely create more confusion. Incentive given by a bank to a merchant for accepting payment through debit card pertaining to that bank. The amount paid back by bank to their customer when they use debit card for financial transaction for purchasing goods or services. The charge to a merchant by a bank for accepting payments from his customers through the bank's debit cards. The incentive given by the government to merchants for promoting digital transactions. Almost all the statements given are having some sort of resemblance. So, I told no, preciseness is very important. What is the answer? Answer is what? Very precise answer is A, C, B and all is coming closer, but the precise answer is C. This came in the news. What is the meaning of these terms? WannaCry, Paytia, Eternal Blue, Cyber Attack. That is the right answer. Two state solution, everyone will answer. Israel, Palestine. Good. They are very much interested in West Asia. Every year you get a question on West Asia. Golan Heights was asked. Right? Arab Spring was asked. Golan Heights. Arab Spring, where Arab Spring started was a question asked. The answer is what? Tunisia, no? Governance of public sector banking. Capital infusion has increased. Public sector banks, to put the public sector banks in order, the merger of associate banks with the parent bank has been affected. So, what is the answer? Whether capital infusion increases or decreases. 2017 it was 35,000 crore. 2018 financial year it became 88,000 crore. Right? So, answer is what? Both. Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, AIIB, it has 80 members. We don't know precisely if you assume. India is the largest shareholder. Now, this is a very, very easy statement. How can India be a larger shareholder when the bank was floated by China? AIIB does not have any member outside Asia. So, I know clearly which will not come. This is called elimination technique. Which will not come? Two should not come because I don't know how many members are there, whether 80 or 90, I don't know. Whether other people outside Asia, they are also present, let us say that we don't know. But sure shot we know that India is not the largest shareholder, China is the largest shareholder of this bank. And with that in mind, we can directly go to the answer, reject the answer, two should not come, only one choice is present. This is elimination technique. So, I tell you, when you are very clear about the statement, that the statement is wrong statement, 100% I know the statement is wrong statement, go directly to the answer. Don't read other statements. If you could clearly say that a statement is a wrong statement, directly go to the answer. Wrong statement, two should not come. We are lucky. B should not come, C should not come, D should not come. So, A is the only choice. So, this you keep as a thumb rule. If you know that it is a wrong statement, don't read the next statement. Go directly to the answer. You will get the answer. Inter-creditor agreement was signed. There are stressed assets. Right? Stressed assets are there. And therefore, they have to resolve this problem of stressed assets. For this, project Shashakt was introduced. based on the recommendation of which committee? Who are the chairperson of Punjab National Bank? Which committee recommendation led to the Project Shashakt to restructure the stressed assets? So that you will fill, that blank you will fill. He was the Punjab National Bank chairperson. Under his leadership, a committee was constituted which was suggesting this Project Shashakt to solve the problem of the stressed assets. Up to 50 crore loan, the bank itself will make a resolution plan within 90 days. If it is more than 50 crore, 50 to 500 crore, then a lead bank will have to be approached. That lead bank will give you a resolution plan within 180 days. And that is what is the point which will guide your answer. What should be the answer? To aim faster resolution of stressed assets of 50 crore or more. So, somewhere we studied 50 crore, but without studying the stressed assets for which only this ICA came under a Project Shashakt, we will not be able to attempt this question. So, the answer is D. Extended Producer Responsibility, EPR, means what? I have produced, it applies to electrical and electronic producers. So, I am making something. After the product had completed its life, now responsibility will come to me to ensure that the product is properly recycled. I am making a product which has some plastic. That product was sold by me to you. You have used the product. After the end of the life of the product, you are dumping the product in the garbage bin. Now it is my responsibility to collect that garbage and recycle that. So this is called as extended producer responsibility. So the treatment of the product after the end of the life of the product is going to the head of, it is passed on to the producer. The responsibility is passed on to the producer. Now, question is, this is an important feature in which of the following? This also requires a very, very precise answer. The answer is e-waste management rules of 2011. So, you think that this question was asked in 19 and this rules was made in 2011, but it came in the news because they wanted to make an amendment to this rules. Therefore, in 2019, it came in the current affairs. Global competitiveness, every year they'll ask a question on reports. 2019 UC reports, 2018 reports. So, list of organizations and the reports will have to be by-hearted by you. Who has published this global competitiveness report? Who? World Economic Forum, right? So, this is related to communication technology, LTE, VOLTE. So, this also becomes very technical. LTE is called as 3G or 4G? 4G. So, first statement is wrong. LTE is going for an improvisation called as VOLTE. So, there is no such voice only technology, data only technology. All technologies are only data based. So, there is no separate technology for voice only technology. Neither one nor two. So, these are the questions which we have found very interesting. And the idea to present these questions is to make you understand what really you are expected to do in the name of current affairs. Just reading current affairs day to day, June 1, November 1, November 2, November 3, If I mechanically read current affairs, I will not be able to answer these questions. So what I have to do is, I have to keep the trend in the mind before I read the news. Because everything boils down to this, whether you are knowing the answer for the questions or not. Right? So preparation should be centering around the UPSC pattern. And remember that students who have written the RBI examination last week, they have told that there is no difference between UPSC examination and RBI examination. Students who have written group 1 mains are telling that, and group 1 prelims are telling, TNPSC group 1 and group 1 mains and prelims, there is no difference between UPSC examination and TNPSC group 1 examination. Today only a student of us I met, he came from Karnataka. He says that in the Karnataka Pradesh Service Commission examination, KPSC examination, in the group 1, they have the same pattern and the same syllabus of UPSC. So, which means that this preparation is an umbrella preparation. The current affairs which you are reading today in the form of UPSC classes will not only be useful for UPSC, in fact, everyone started becoming UPSC. All PCS people have become UPSC. So, there is more and more trend of the State Public Service Commission moving in the direction of UPSC, the bank service, banking examination moving in the direction of UPSC, including RBI moving in the direction of UPSC. So, therefore, this current affairs class will not only be useful for your UPSC exam, it will be useful for all examinations you write. Because that is how the questions are lifted in TNPSC or Karnataka Public Service Commission or RBI. You cannot make a distinction between this is UPSC current affairs and this is TNPSC current affairs. Gone are the days where when you can make a distinction between the state services and the UPSC. Today everyone is following the direction of UPSC. So when you prepare for UPSC, automatically you prepare for all the competitive examination. Of course, our single pointed focus is only on UPSC examination, but still any examination which comes in the way, you can simply attempt those examinations, at least to tell to others that you have cleared some good number of examinations. So that is to keep your track record for yourself, that I have cleared many examination doesn't mean that I'll go and join, but I have to have in my store many success stories. Understood? I told you why current affairs is very, very essential. Prelims, mains, essay, interview is fully packed by current affairs only. So therefore, normally we advise students to go reading the newspaper of the day, as it gives you a very important source of question for the interview people. The first topic which we have to take up for today's classes, we'll take up some topics. These topics came from November 1st to November 15. So we have selected, doesn't mean that all the 15 days only these topics came. We have to give you some sort of orientation in the form of class to tell you this is how you have to look at the current affairs. Sarkaria Commission and the discretionary power of the governor came in the news. So, already Sarkaria Commission has laid the rules related to the governor when he is going to invite a party to form the government. You know what is happening in Maharashtra. Governor was having discretion, is having discretion according to our constitution. Because when you read Article 163, Clause 1, it says the governor of the state will have to act as per the advice of the Council of Ministers. But at the same time, he has to act even without the advice of the Council of Ministers. So it says that the governor shall act according to the advice given by the Council of Ministers, except in so far as he is required to act as per his discretion. The word discretion is mentioned. When you come to Article 163, Clause 2, when there is a debate on whether a power is discretionary power or not for the governor, he himself will decide whether his power is discretionary or not. So, 163 Clause 1 and Clause 2 clearly speaks about governor's discretion. Sarkaria Commission wanted to ensure that the discretion is not very arbitrarily used. Because in our scheme of polity, governor is an agent of the center. Right? We have a Canadian type of federation where governor is appointed by the center. Therefore, he acts as the agent of the center. When the Council of Ministers will be swearing in, when the first sitting of the new house will be summoned by the governor, needs to be known. You tell me in the sequence whether the first sitting of the new legislature will come first or the swearing in of the Council of Ministers will happen first. What comes first? Swearing in of the Council of Ministers comes first. So, first government should be formed. Then, the governor will tell when the house will sit to make the first transaction. Based on the advice of the government, he will convene, he will summon the legislature. And suppose if the strength of the, if the majority is little bit dicey, right? If the government is not having an absolute majority, then definitely he will tell the government to go for a floor test. In that floor test, the chief minister will have to go for a confidence vote. If the confidence vote or the confidence motion was defeated, then it is natural that there will be a resignation of the chief minister. All the council of ministers will go along with the CM. So this you should know, that first swearing in of the new government will take place, then based on the government's advice, the first sitting of the legislature will have to take place. Now, if no party is having absolute majority, who will be invited to form the government according to Sarkaria Commission? Sarkaria Commission is giving an order of precedence. It is giving an order of precedence. So, first, who should be called by the governor? Alliance of parties which were formed before the election, pre-poll alliance. That should be the first priority, pre-poll alliance. If pre-poll alliance government is not coming, then second priority is the single largest party. So, first is pre-poll alliance, otherwise second priority is, second preference is single largest party, right? As we know in Maharashtra, the single largest party, when pre-poll alliance is not forming the government because of the problem between Shiv Sena and BJP, the governor was inviting who to form the government? Single largest party. But BJP said, no, I am not interested. Then it has to go and ask the NCP. Like that, it kept on asking many. Third is a post election coalition. Post election coalition. So, after the election, there will be an alliance, but the alliance partners will have to join the government. Otherwise, what will happen? If they gave from outside, if they give support from outside without joining the government, what will happen? They will constantly threaten the government, instability will be there. And fourth choice is what? A post-election alliance without the alliance partners joining the government. So already Sarkaria laid this rules. He has given the recommendation. First, pre-poll alliance. Second, single largest party. Third choice, post-poll alliance with members, with alliance partners joining the government. Finally, only post-poll alliance with members not joining the government, giving support from outside. So this is what you need to know. When we have spoken about confidence motion, we can also speak about whether confidence motion is there in the constitution. No. Whether confidence motion is in the rules of procedure of Lok Sabha. Neither it is there in the constitution nor it is there in the rules of procedure of Lok Sabha. But if you compare confidence motion with no confidence motion, no confidence motion is clearly mentioned in the rules of procedure of Lok Sabha, rule number 198. Mentions this no confidence motion. Now, history of no confidence motion needs to be seen. Some historical background is needed about no confidence motion. You tell me who first brought no confidence motion in the center. Who first brought the no confidence motion in the center? We can always assume that it should be against Nehru. We can even assume that it should be after the China-India War 1962. And who brought the no confidence motion for the first time in the history of politics or history of Indian polity? It was an independent MP, and we know that MP, he was an independent MP that time. He brought the no confidence motion. His name was Acharya J.B. Kriplani. He brought the first no confidence motion. Sometimes historical facts will be inserted by UPSC in one of the statements. So you should know about the background of the story. Everyone knows that 50 MPs are needed for initiation of the no confidence motion. It can be introduced only in Lok Sabha. It is there in the rules of procedure 198. All these things we know. If I ask a question, who first introduced this no confidence motion, not many people will know, and this UPSC will know. Therefore, they will put this as a statement. Just tell me against whom maximum number of no confidence motion came. Definitely against whom? Maximum number of no confidence motion was brought against Indira Gandhi. Indira Gandhi. Maximum number of no confidence motion came against Indira Gandhi, right? You know that the first no confidence motion which was successful was brought by Y.B. Chavan. Y.B. Chavan brought the first no confidence motion against Morarji Desai. But look at what happened. Before the no confidence motion was put for voting, Morarji Desai resigned. In 1999, you know what happened? 270 members voted in favor of no confidence motion against Vajpayee government, and Vajpayee government got 269 votes. By a margin of one vote, Vajpayee government fell in 1999. And 2018, there was a no confidence motion against the government. So NCM can be introduced by an independent MP also. Not necessarily by the opposition party, it can be an independent member of parliament. Right? So, Sarkaria Commission deliberation was taking place, that is the picture. Secondly, Ayodhya verdict. We know that there was an important landmark judgment given by the Supreme Court some time back, and there was a unanimous verdict given by the Supreme Court. All said 2.77 acre of land will have to be given to Lord Ram. So Lord Ram won the case. Should not be seen in this way. right? 5 acres of land was given to those who were filing a petition before the Supreme Court. So, something related to history. The petitioners said that in 1528, the army commander of Babur, he was building a mosque. Without demolishing the Ram temple, without demolishing the structure already present, whether it is Ram temple or not, nobody knows. Without demolishing an already present structure. So they said that there was no, issue, because it was properly constructed without affecting the others. In 1991, there was an act enacted by the parliament called as Places of Worship Act 1991. Places of Worship Act 1991. And that act is having a section 3, which says that conversion of the places of worship to another place of worship shall not be done. A place of worship of one religious community should not be converted into another place of worship of another religious community. Simply it says you cannot transfer the place of worship. You cannot transfer the place of worship. So a place of worship of the Hindus shall not be transferred to another place of worship. Even within the same religion, there are many sect. There are many groups, subgroups within the great religion, and they are called as denomination. So, one denomination is worshipping in this place. They should not be told to go to another place of worship. Even within the same religion, there should not be any transfer of the place of worship. But remember, the act is telling this provision will not apply to Ayodhya. This act was enacted in 1991. Babri Masjid was demolished in 1992. So, the act is exempting Ayodhya. The act is also exempting the places which will come under Archaeological Sites and Remains Act. Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1958. So, those places coming under Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1958 and Ayodhya site will not be covered under this act. So, therefore, it becomes easy for litigation to be made. So, what the Parliamentary Act says, you don't tell one religious community to go to another place to worship. If they are worshipping in one place, let them worship in the same place. Don't tell them to go to some other place and worship, according to the 1991 Act. But the Act says this provision will not apply to the 1958 Act covered places as well as Ayodhya. So, what the verdict says? It says equality of all religion. It says secular state is there in India. Right? It says within 3 months there should be a trust and there should be a construction which has to start. All these aspects we definitely knew. Right? What you have to know additionally is that there is an article in constitution called as 142 article. Article 142. For the first time, Supreme Court was invoking Article 142 in a civil case. Involving private individuals. For the first time, Article 142 was involved by or invoked by Supreme Court in a civil case involving individual petitioners. Article 142 was asked in last year prelims examination. What 142 says is, if a case comes before the Supreme Court, Supreme Court will have to do complete justice. It has to render complete justice. So it has to pass an order in order to give complete justice to the case lying before the Supreme Court. Any case, any matter lying before the Supreme Court will have to be given complete justice by the Supreme Court. And you know that that order should be enforced throughout India. That order should be enforced throughout India. And how it will be enforced throughout India? Article 142 says, through a parliamentary law, the order of the Supreme Court under 142 should be enforced throughout India. So the manner of introduction or the manner of enforcement of the judgment under 142 will be decided by parliament law. Till parliament comes with a law, the manner of enforcement of the judgment will be made by president. So I have told you three things: complete justice, number two, enforceability based on parliamentary law, number three, if parliamentary law is not there regarding enforcement of the judgment of the Supreme Court under 142, who will make the rules for the enforcement of the judgment of the Supreme Court? If parliament law is not there, then who? Till parliament makes a law, who will have to make rules for enforcement of the law, judgment of the Supreme Court under 142? President of India. Till parliamentary law comes, President of India will ensure that Supreme Court judgment under 142 is implemented throughout India. So everyone knows about Ayodhya verdict, they know about 2.77 acres of land, but little bit known will be what? 142, which was already asked by UPSC last year. Complete justice, enforced throughout India, manner of enforcement decided by parliamentary law, till parliament makes a law, manner of enforcement will be decided by the President of India. Sabarimala verdict, you know. There are two types of temples, Tantric and Vedantic or Vedic. Tantric and Vedic, there are two types of places, Tantric and Vedic, religious places. And Sabarimala is belonging to which form, Tantric or Vedic tradition? Vedic tradition means temple is a place of worship. God is present, go worship. But Tantric tradition says temple is not just a place of worship of God, temple is a source of energy. It is a source of energy. The entire temple is a source of energy. So Sabarimala temple belongs to Tantric order, not Vedic order. And secondly, he is a celibate throughout life. He is a brahmachari. Which is why the Devasthanam board disallowed women. But 2018 Supreme Court judgment was in the 4:1 made a judgment that women can enter Sabarimala temple. But there are some temples in other religions as well which prohibits women, like Haji Ali Darga in case of Islam, and there's a Parsi temple called as fire temple into which women are not allowed, right? So why Sabarimala judgment came in the news was, this was referred to a larger bench. The earlier constitutional bench containing 5 judges gave judgment last year 2018, and now it is referred to the 7 judges bench. Some questions are asked to the larger bench in this case. Whether court can decide on the practices essential to a religion, whether the practices essential to religion comes under Article 26, and if a public interest litigation was made by a person belonging to another religious community, how can we entertain this? A PIL is filed by a person belonging to another religion. To what extent we can entertain such PILs if the PIL is filed by a person belonging to another religion, not connected to this temple, he belongs to another religion. So these are the three main questions asked by the asked before the larger bench consisting of 7 judges. What practices should be regarded as essentials to the religion? Can court decide this? Secondly, whether essentials of religion comes under 26 article? And thirdly, if PIL is fined by a person belonging to some other religion, to what extent should we entertain this public interest litigation? These three questions came before the larger bench, and the larger bench is expected to give the verdict. So, there is a temple called as Fire Temple, Agiyari Temple of the Parsi community, A-G-I-Y-A-R-I, Agiyari Temple, Parsi community. It is a fire temple, F-I-R-E, a temple of fire. This temple, Parsi temple, will not allow Parsi women. So, this is about Sabarimala temple verdict. It is referred to the 7 judges bench. 3 important questions are to be answered by the larger bench consisting of 7 judges. RTI Act and Chief Justice of India. So, why it came in the news? You tell me, why it came in the news, RTI Act? The definition of public authority, should it include Chief Justice of India? Supreme Court, headed by the Chief Justice of India, said Chief Justice of India will come under the public authority. Now, which is section of RTI Act defines public authority? Section 2, Clause H. Section 2, Clause H defines public authority. It says public authority means constitutional authority, statutory authority, government created authority. Government by order can also, make an authority which is coming under public authority. It says NGOs receiving substantial fund from the government also should be called public authority. NGOs receiving substantial fund from the government comes under the category of public authority. So, private authority will not come under. Public authority will come, and public authority under Section 2, Clause H includes even non-governmental organization who receive substantial fund from the government. Understood. There is another Section 8 which is exempting disclosure provisions. On the following grounds, information need not be disclosed. Exemption list was given by Section 8 of RTI Act. It says in the interest of the security of the country, sovereignty of the country, friendly relation, suppose a foreign government is giving information to you, you need not disclose. Whether trade secret should be disclosed, whether IPR provision, IPR related issue should be disclosed. No trade secret can be disclosed. IPR need not be disclosed. And most importantly, deliberations made by the Council of Ministers, that is cabinet papers, will not be disclosed. So, they are deliberating. The Council of Ministers are deliberating. Deliberation papers or the cabinet papers are exempted from RTI Act. The Chief Information Commissioner a year back told political parties should come under RTI Act, but political parties said we will not come under RTI Act. When CJI comes under RTI Act, definitely what is the applicability of this act with respect to political party again will become discussed. So once again the discussion will start whether we should include political party within the ambit of RTA Act. 2019 there was an amendment made to RTA Act. What amendment? Section 13 and section 16 of RTA Act was amended in 2019. It was passed by both House of Parliament in July 2019 with respect to RTA Act, and therefore it was criticized. Tell me, what amendment was affected in 2019, July, by Parliament with respect to RTA Act? Chief Information Commissioner earlier was having the fixed term, 5 years or 65 years. But today, it will be decided by the central government. He was having a salary equivalent to Chief Election Commissioner. His salary also will be decided by the government. The government says, CIC is not a constitutional body. Whereas, Election Commission is a constitutional body. So, we cannot compare CIC with CEC. What is the salary of the information commissioners in the center? Their salary will be equivalent to the election commissioners. Now, it will be decided by the center. What is the salary of the chief information commissioner of the state? Equivalent to who? Election commissioner. Central information commissioner and State Chief Information Commissioner will draw the same salary, equivalent to the election commissioners. But now it will be decided by the center. What is the salary of the State Information Commissioners? Equivalent to the Chief Secretary. But what will be their salary now? Decided by the center. So as far as the fixed term is concerned, now there is no fixed term. As far as salary is concerned, there is no equivalent salary as that of the election commission. And earlier CIC was given the status of Chief Justice of India, Supreme Court Judge. CIC was given the status of Supreme Court Judge, but the amendment says he is not having the status of Supreme Court Judge because his order can be challenged before the High Court. You cannot challenge the order of the Supreme Court in the High Court. You cannot challenge the order of Supreme Court in the High Court because Supreme Court is apex court than the High Court. So, your status is not equivalent to judge of the Supreme Court because your order can be challenged before the High Court. So, therefore, all the opposition parties were telling that you have ensured that the information commissioners are totally dependent on the mercy of the central government. Earlier, they had an independence, but that independence in the form of fixed term is eroded because of this amendment. That is what is the point which you need to know as for the amendment to the article, amendment to RTA Act was made in 2019. So, three things I told you. One is public authority definition, secondly exemption list, and thirdly amendment of RTA Act. Have you understood this? Article 370-350-35A, Union Territory of Ladakh, Jammu Kashmir. A small history you need to know. You know that 1947 October, instrument of accession was signed by Maharaja Hari Singh. In that instrument of accession, he says, I am transferring three of my powers to the central government. One is defense, second is foreign relation, third is communication. All the three things, except these three things, I have my say. And that was the instrument of accession. But 1948, what happened was, an interim government was formed by Maharaja with Sheikh Abdullah as the head. This happened in 1948. So, I am telling the chronology so that you can understand the story better. 1947, instrument of accession. 1948, interim government headed by Sheikh Abdullah. And 1949, July 1949, Sheikh Abdullah and three others became members of Constituent Assembly of India, because they have to now pressurize the Constituent Assembly to introduce Article 370. For that purpose, they entered the Constituent Assembly of India, Sheikh Abdullah and three other members. October 1949, Article 370 was inserted. So, October 1949, Article 370 was inserted into the Constitution. In 1952, there was a Delhi Agreement. In that Delhi Agreement, Jammu Kashmir citizens became citizens of India. Indian citizenship was extended to the citizens of Jammu Kashmir according to Delhi Agreement 1952. 1954, Presidential Order was made, which inserted Article 35A. Presidential Order was made by inserting Article 35A. What 35A says? It gives power to the state legislature of Jammu Kashmir to, define permanent residents of the state and give some special rights and privileges related to inheritance of property, reservation in government jobs. So, this is the change effected by 1954 President's Order. Right? You read Article 370. 370 gives power to the President of India to give exemption or do modification of Indian Constitution when it comes to Jammu Kashmir people. Article 370 gives power to the President of India to modify the Constitution or exempt some provisions of Constitution when it applies to people of Jammu Kashmir. So, based on 370, 1954 Presidential Order was made. It says the state legislature of Jammu Kashmir can define the permanent residents of Jammu Kashmir, give them some special rights and privileges with respect to inheritance, with respect to government jobs, etc. When it happened? 1954. 1957, January 26, the Constituent Assembly of Jammu Kashmir was dissolved. Constituent Assembly of Jammu Kashmir was dissolved. So, see the chronology. 1947, Maharaja said only on three subjects Indian Parliament can make law. But through the Presidential Order, using Article 370 only, through the Presidential Order, the center ensured that 260 articles out of 295 applies to Jammu Kashmir. 94 items present in Union List applies to Jammu Kashmir. 26 items present in the concurrent list applies to Jammu Kashmir. So, already the practically speaking, 370 was used to dilute 370. And what was done by the previous governments was done in a very concrete way by the present government. What they did indirectly, that the previous government did directly. There is one doctrine in Indian polity which says, what you cannot do directly, that you cannot do indirectly. What is that doctrine? A doctrine in Indian polity says, what you cannot do directly, that you cannot do indirectly. Doctrine of colorable legislation. It is called as doctrine of colorable legislation. what you cannot do directly, that you cannot do indirectly. That is called as doctrine of colorable legislation. Now, we said indirectly in the last 60 plus years, using 370, 370 was diluted. And this time, using 370, 370 was abrogated. Understanding the process or not? Earlier 370 was used to dilute 370 because through 370 presidential order ensured that almost many provisions of constitution will be applicable to Jammu Kashmir. But the final assault on 370 came in 2019 through the presidential order made under 370 to abrogate 370. Using the power of the President of India under 370, a presidential order was made to abrogate 370. So, same article was used to finish the same article. 370 was used to abrogate 370. It was not used through 368 route. 368 route was not used. 370 was used to finish 370. Because 370 clearly tells president can modify the constitution, exempt some provisions of constitution when it applies to Jammu Kashmir. So, he modified 370 through 370. And that presidential order was, you know, coming to be known to the parliament through the home minister. There was a resolution which was passed to repeal Article 370. There was a bill which was moved under Article 3 to create two union territories, one Jammu Kashmir, another is Ladakh. Jammu Kashmir will have a legislature, whereas Ladakh will not have a legislature. Jammu Kashmir will have a lieutenant governor who can act in his discretion, whereas Ladakh will be having a lieutenant governor who has no discretion, but he has to go by the advice of the advisors who will be appointed by the central government. Right? So, when you wanted to redraw the boundary of the states, you have to use Article 3, and that is why one bill was brought under Article 3. A resolution was brought to repeal Article 370. And a new presidential order was brought, the 2009 order, to finish the 1954 order. So, same route, a route which was seen as a route for, a route which was seen as a route for autonomy was used by the government to end the state itself. Because in our scheme of things, constitution, parliament has the power to make or break the states even without the consent of the state. Right? So, I think the story now becomes very clear what really happened, that using 370, 370 was abrogated. Under 370, president is given power to abrogate 370, and therefore the government did. Is not removed from the book of constitution. 370 is still present, because if you wanted to remove 370, you have to use only 368 to remove from the book. So, 370 is there, but 370 is not there. In the sense, there is a 370 literally present in article, present in constitution, because you cannot remove 370 without 368. But you can kill 370 using 370. It is there as a dead letter. They can do that only through 368, that removing something, putting into something can be done only by 368. Therefore, the opposition party told what? How can you do this? Using 370, killing 370, how can you do this? There is a fundamental flaw in 370. Using 370, you can kill 370. Because it is very temporary under part 21, temporary transitional provision. But Supreme Court of India last year told 2018 said, it is not temporary, it is permanent. You know that. In 1960s, Supreme Court of India gave a judgment. 370 is not temporary, 370 is only permanent because it is present. In 2018 also, Supreme Court gave a judgment. 370 is not temporary, 370 is permanent. But what happened in 2018, when the Mehbooba Mufti government became a minority government, then 356 was used to ensure that there is no government. Only when the government is present, you have to seek the concurrence of the government. When there is no government, then you need to seek the concurrence of the governor, and governor is the agent of the center. So the process becomes very easy. Already planned move. 2018 itself, they ensured that state government is not there. Right? So 2018 December, state legislature also dissolved. And who is left? State Constituent Assembly was not there since 1957, State Constituent Assembly is not there. If you are not there, then at least state government should be there, state legislature should be there, state government is not there, state legislature is not there, then who else is left? Governor is left. Finish 370. Right? This is very interesting, and we have a special section on this in the current affairs class. This is called as oxymoron. You know what oxymoron? Opposites. See, it is clearly misunderstood. Example, clear misunderstood. Opposites. It's pretty ugly. Pretty ugly opposites. Seriously funny. Serious but funny. Found but missing. So such things, we think something, but actually that thing is completely wrong. So clearly we will misunderstand something. For example, correcta tapapano. கரெக்டாக தப்பு பண்ணும் அதுதான் ஆக்சிமோரன். டூ திங்ஸ் வி ஆர் ஆடிங் ஆஸ் அ நாவல்ட்டி இன் திஸ் கிளாஸ். ஒன் இஸ் ஆக்சிமோரான், அனதர் இஸ் டிடெக்டிவ். டிடெக்டிவ் மீன்ஸ் வாட் யூ ஹாவ் விச் யூ டோன்ட் நோ. யூ ஹாவ் சம்திங் அரவுண்ட் யூ பட் யூ ஆர் நாட் அவேர் ஆஃப் தட். We'll come to that later. First, oxymoron. I'll ask you a question. Oxymoron is something which is going against your common sense. It simply goes against your common sense. Common sense tells you something, but really it is different. Basically, they will ask some questions related to schemes and the ministry. There was a question which was asked. Genetic Engineering Approval Committee comes under which ministry was a question asked. Some time back, Genetic Engineering, there was an answer called as Biotechnology Department. So we normally study Genetic Engineering in Biotechnology. Therefore, we tend to answer that Biotechnology Department will be our answer. But it will be what? A wrong answer, and the right answer will be Ministry of Environment and Forest. Under them only Genetic Engineering Approval Committee is there, which only gives, you know, which only gives approval to BT cotton, BT brinjal. All these BT varieties will be given approval only by genetic engineering approval committee not coming under biotechnology or science and technology, but coming under environment and forest ministry. So common sense tells you to select something, but we select some other thing. But the answer is some other thing. This is called as oxymoron. So you'll be introduced to such oxymoron because these oxymorons are very much present in UPSC. This is a question which I was asking you, that fame normally, this faster adoption and manufacturing of hybrid electric vehicles is an initiative of which of the ministry? So we may think some other ministry, but the answer is heavy industry ministry. So this is how we think some other ministry, but the answer is definitely another ministry. FAME 2, FAME means what? Faster adoption and manufacturing of hybrid and electric vehicles. So we have a target to ensure that 30% of the vehicles are hybrid vehicles. It is running on non-conventional sources. There was a FAME 1 2015, FAME 2 2019. So FAME 1 was introduced only in 2015 for a 2-year period, and they extended this FAME 1 in the form of FAME 2. This was launched from 2019. This was launched in 2019 and it will be till 2022. So FAME, heavy industry ministry, and these are the four important aspects: creating more demand for the hybrid vehicles, technology development, pilot projects, and charging infrastructure. See, there is a criticism today against even FAME too, because it gives you some important awareness about the use of hybrid vehicles. 10,000 crores earmarked for this FAME 2, right? They have done many things. For example, the GST was reduced from 12% to 5%. GST got reduced, and some 1.5 lakh rupees you will get a deduction in the interest which you are paying for the loan you have taken to buy the electric vehicles. All these things they are doing. But there are certain limitations of this FAME 2. The charging unit will have to be based on unconventional energy. So you have a hybrid vehicle, but you are putting the charger in the conventional power supply. So therefore, they are telling that charging units also will have to be subsidized. And toll exemption will have to be given to the hybrid vehicles. Toll exemption, there should not be any parking fee for the EV, for the electric vehicles or the hybrid vehicles. There should not be toll charges for the hybrid vehicles. So much more you need to do, but the point is, some good things have happened, that you have ensured 30% of the vehicles will be hybrid vehicles by 2030. That is a very big promise which we are making. The reason is, we have a National Electric Mobility Mission Plan. 2020 is having a target. National Electric Mobility Mission Plan 2020 target is what? 7 million hybrid vehicles will be sold by 2020. 7 million hybrid vehicles. And look at the saving of fuel. 9,500 million liters of fuel will be saved. Which means that in the next 3 years, because of this hybrid vehicles, you can save 1.72 lakh crore. You can reduce your oil import bill. Ethana kodi, 1.72 lakh crore will be saved by you in the next 3 years with respect to the oil bill. You are importing that much oil. You are paying so heavily to the import bill of the oil, you will be able to cut 1.72 lakh crore in the next 3 years on the oil bill, import bill, right? So job creations are there definitely. 2 million tons of reduction in pollution. It's a green vehicle, so it is not emitting any pollution. So all these are some facts which we have to memorize. But what you need to know is National Electric Mobility Mission Plan, under which only you have FAME 1, you have FAME 2. So these are some of the things factually. I have told you the outlay, 10,000 crore outlay for 3 years. 30% of electric vehicles will be there by 2030. 65 million jobs will be in the auto sector. But what is the problem which you are facing? The automobile sector is monopolized by the private people. Private people are very skeptical about this entire mission. So they are not ready to invest a huge amount of money in the hybrid vehicles. Recently, Hyundai came out with a car, a hybrid car, and you know that the price which they have told was around 30 lakhs, very costly, right? So the automobile sector is very skeptical about this, because if there is a new government comes, they will scrap this old government policy. So they are not ready to take risk, as a result of which this mission, if it has to become successful, you have to convince the private sector, who has literal monopoly over the vehicle market. So this is a deductive corner which I was speaking about. Something which you know around you, about you. Something which you should know about you, around you, but we don't know. For example, there are many such examples which I can give, many such instances I can give in the UPSC question. That in one of the years, they asked about something written on the tube light. In one of the years in the main examination, they asked you comparison of two models of washing machine. In one of the papers in prelims, they asked you about probiotic dahi, probiotic curd. What is probiotic, they asked. And some time back, they asked about the Bluetooth technology. Right? Bluetooth technology, they asked about the frequency of the Bluetooth technology. And in one of the papers, they were asking about no trans fat means what? So all these things are around us, but unfortunately, we have not taken note of that. And that is the aspect of this called as deductive corner. What is the pixel of your mobile camera? What is the pixel of your mobile? What is the pixel of your mobile camera? You have a cell phone. There is a camera in the cell phone. What is the resolution of your camera in your cell phone? Cell phone camera's resolution is what? What is the resolution of your cell phone camera? When you go to the shop, you ask, the first thing is, what is the resolution of the camera? So what is the resolution of the camera? What is the resolution of the camera normally? What is the maximum resolution camera available in the cell phone? 40 megapixels. So what is the resolution of your eye? What is the resolution of your eye? We have a camera. In the form of two eyes, you have cameras. We know the resolution of the cell phone camera, but we don't know the resolution of our camera. What is the resolution of your eye? And all the cell phone companies are telling that we have to walk miles to touch that resolution of the human eye. What is the resolution of the human eye? Any range? 500 plus megapixels. 500 plus megapixels. The top resolution camera in the cell phone is just 40, but the human eye resolution is 500 plus megapixels. So this is about you, but we do not know. And I told that something which we should know, but we are not knowing, that will be known to UPSC. Hence, they will put a question on this. So this area, two important areas which we are introducing in this class. One is oxymorons, and secondly, deductive corner, which means that something which is around us, something which is within us, something which is about us, but we do not know that. So therefore, the main intention of this corner, deductive corner, is you must not see, you must observe. Observation is not seeing. Observation means interconnection amongst the facts, that is called as observation. So don't see, but observe, right? And secondly, don't hear, but listen, right? So this is the question which I have asked. Feni River. There was a memorandum of understanding signed between India and which country so that they will go for cooperation and coordination of action? Bangladesh and India. They have agreed to sign a MOU on transboundary river cooperation. There are 7 rivers, and out of the 7 rivers, this river, Feni River, came in the news. This is the map of Feni River. It is originating in Tripura, in a place called as Sabrum, and it then passes through Bangladesh, then gets it merges into Bay of Bengal. So Feni River, along with 6 others river, totally 7 rivers, there is a MOU signed. There was an agreement made between India and Bangladesh, because we wanted to give water to the people of Sabrum. It's a place, it's a town having 7,000 population who do not have water. The ground water is having so much of iron content in that place called Sabrum. So therefore, Feni River agreement will give water to the people of Tripura. You should understand that Tripura is just 70 km from the Chittagong port. So if there is a bridge over this river, then definitely we can connect Tripura with that of Chittagong port, and this will definitely ease the free movement of trade. It will ease the movement of trade of goods. There is an important corridor called as BCIM corridor, Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar corridor, and because of this Feni River construction project, BCIM corridor will become easy. So Feni River came in the news. This river originates in a town called Sabrum in Tripura, and therefore Tripura, Feni River, cooperation with Bangladesh needs to be known. Credit rating agencies. There are international credit rating agencies who will measure the credit worthiness of entities who wanted to borrow money from institutions. So I wanted to borrow money from a bank. On what basis bank will give loan to me? For the bank to make a judgment falsely about me, about my repaying capacity, credit rating institutions will give credit rating to the individuals. It's like this, that you have this Ola cab. After the drive is over, after the travel is over, they are asking you for rating. 1 star, 2 star, 3 star, 4 star, 5 star. So you should observe this. After dropping us, the taxi driver, the call taxi driver will tell you, kindly give more rating to me. Why? Because if many people are giving 5-star rating, he will be given more offer by the company. If you get poor rating, you will not be given any drive at all. So always you have seen that no driver will have a rating which is less than 4 stars. Most of the drivers will have 4.7, 4.9, some people will be having 5. Like the Ola company is telling you to rate the driver, they are giving the reasons. There is a quantification which they are doing. Why you have given poor rating, you tell us. 1 star you say it's very poor. Tell us the reason for the poor starring. You are given a list of reasons, you have to select the reason. And this is a qualitative measure as well as quantitative measure. In the same fashion, the individual, any entity asking for loan will be given creditworthiness by the crediting agencies, credit rating agencies. But the problem is, there are some international credit rating agencies, international credit rating agencies like Moody's, like Fitch Rating, they are not regulated by SEBI. They are not regulated. Who are regulated? The three important Indian players are regulated. CRISIL, ICRA and CARE Rating. So they are Indian companies rating the credit worthiness of the entities, like individual can be rated for their credit worthiness. Secondly, a company can be rated for their credit worthiness. A national government can be rated, even the state government can be rated. So individual can be rated, corporation can be rated, state government can be rated, central government can be rated. And why this rating agency came in the news was, Moody rating company rated India very poorly. Because of the slowdown of Indian economy, they gave a poor rating, they downgraded India's status in the rating, and therefore it became controversial. So you should know, CRISIL rating company has 70% of the market share. The reason for this credit rating is, I will be easily availing the loan if my rating is good. And the bank will also decide whether it is worth giving loan to him or not. It will be easily decided by the investor, whether I should invest in that company or not. I can take an easy decision. As an investor, I can take easy decision because of the credit rating. As an individual, as a company, I can easily go and take a loan from the institutions because of my credit rating. And the rating will be like this, from 300 to 900. It will be in the score of 300 to 900. If you cross 750 to 900, if you cross 750, then it is like 5-star rating. Right? Core investment company. AAA means best, 5-star. Then second rating is AA, then A, B, like that the rating goes. Yeah, they'll be done. See, every company have their own standard system. They don't have a standard system across the companies. They have their own scientific assessment. So what happens? You can tell the rating company to give you a very good rating and take that certificate, go to your bank, take loan, run away. Possible or not? So we have to regulate all the rating agencies. We have only 3 agencies in India regulated in India. But other international players who are giving credit rating, they are not regulated by India. So therefore, there is a need for regulation of the rating agencies, standardization of the assessments made by the rating agencies. I may use one method based on which you are very poor. He may use another method based on which you are very good. So I am rated differently by different companies. I will take the rating which is higher and I will go to the bank and take the loan which will become bad loan after some time. Standardization of the rating is what is needed, which is why it came into use. Core investment company only for, you know, investment in the industries, core industries, you have this core investment companies. Basically, core investment companies are who? They will invest in the infrastructure. They are who? Non-banking financial companies who have 90% of their asset in the debt instruments like bonds, shares. They have an asset value of 100 plus crores. So, core investment companies are non-banking financial companies having an asset worth of more than 100 crores, out of which 90% of the asset will have to be in the form of debt instruments like bond, share, etc. So, they are called as core investment companies. Why it came in the news? Core investment companies were regulated by RBI in 2010. So, regulation of CICs started in 2010. And now that there is a committee constituted under Tapan Ray, which has to review the regulation system in place, suggest recommendation for improvising the regulation of the CICs. So, from prelims point of view, core investment companies are non-banking financial companies. They should have asset value of more than 100 crores. 90% of that will have to be in the form of debt instruments. CICs were regulated in 2010. There was a regulatory framework put in place in 2010. And now that there is a new regulatory regime which is needed, they have to review the old regulatory regime. They have to make it more standardized. And therefore, there was a committee constituted called as Tapan Ray Committee. Tapan Ray Committee will recommend on the new regulation system for the core investment companies. So, this is from the prelims point of view. Edmont Group came in the news because in 2020, we are going to host the conference of this Edmont Group. This group is made out of 164 intelligence, financial intelligence units. There are many intelligence units of the government across the country, across the world. Financial intelligence units, 164 financial intelligence units, 164 financial intelligence units have created this group called as Egmont Group. And the conference of this group called as No Money for Terror is going to be hosted by India in 2020. Right? This group conference is hosted by India in 2020. Related to this group is an independent intergovernmental organization called as FATF, Financial Action Task Force. In 1989, FATF was formed by G7 members. First to combat money laundering. Then in the year 2000, they extended their function to not just money laundering, but also terror funding and human trafficking. I am speaking about Financial Action Task Force, FATF. When it was formed in 1989 by G7 countries, only one intention, I should ensure that there is no money laundering. Money laundering means converting the black money into white money. That is called as money laundering. But by 2000, two other functions were included under the ambit of FATF. One is terror funding and the second is human trafficking. So there are three important areas of action by FATF: money laundering, terror funding, and thirdly human trafficking. In the year 2018, Pakistan was put into the grey list for the second time. There are two types of lists maintained by FATF. One is blacklist. In that blacklist, there are two countries. One is Iran, another is North Korea. In the grey list, for the second time, FATF has added Pakistan. Three countries, importantly, India, US and UK, wanted Pakistan to be listed in the blacklist. But the chair of the current FATF is China, who is very close to Pakistan. And because of China, because of Turkey, Pakistan was not put under the blacklist, but it was put under the grey list, which means that your actions will have to be changed by you. We have 27 goals. You have to achieve these goals. But we have seen that you are the main source of terror funding. Money from some places, black money will go to Pakistan. From Pakistan, it will be distributed to the terrorist organization. So therefore, you are involving in money laundering, you are involving in terror funding. And the conference of this group, in which members of FATF are also present in this group, is about no money for terror. So I have spoken about Egmont group, conference 2020 hosted by India, related FATF, we have spoken about FATF as well. World Customs Organization. Where is the headquarters of this World Customs Organization? Brussels. Brussels. So it is a very, very important organization because it will help us to make agreements which will increase the ease of trade. It will help us to make agreements to ease the trade. It will protect IPR, right? IPR protection, and then customs duty will be rationalized. So these are some of the works of World Customs Organization, and India is a member of this. There is a HS code. There is a HS code. What do you mean by HS code? A harmonized system which ensures that there is a easy trade of the commodities which were given HS code. It is a 6-digit code. So it is a 6-digit code, and if a commodity gets this code, then that commodity can be traded very easily. Customs clearing and all will happen very fastly. There are 5000 commodities in the world which has this HS code. HS code is used by 200 countries today, and it came in the news. The Ministry of Commerce and Industry has given HS code for what? HS code will be given by the concerned ministry of the member country of World Customs Organization. Since India is also a member of World Customs Organization, the Ministry of Commerce has given recently a harmonized system of code for a particular thing which is having some value, not material but national. It has given HS code to Kadi. So they can ask you that the central government has given HS code based on the rules made by World Customs Organization to which of the following commodity? The commodity is Kadi. So Kadi has got this code recently, therefore HS code is important. So the question may be on Kadi, HS code, World Customs Organization. There are 5000 commodities which has got this HS code, out of which Kadi is also getting included. If you get this HS code, trade of that commodity bearing the HS code will be very faster. So seamless trade will be because of the HS code, and Kadi has been given this HS code not by World Customs Organization but by the Commerce Ministry based on the rules and regulations made by the World Customs Organization. Wasteland Atlas. You tell me which state is having maximum wasteland. From the picture you can find out that the states having the largest wasteland is Rajasthan. Wasteland Atlas 2019 is made by which ministry? Ministry of Rural Development plus Remote Sensing in collaboration with Remote Sensing Center under which ministry? Department of Space. So this is the project of Rural Development Ministry in collaboration with Remote Sensing Center under the Department of Space. So this is the fifth atlas. This is the fifth atlas, and what this atlas is telling you is that for the first time 8 million hectares of wasteland of Jammu Kashmir was mapped. So far wasteland of Jammu Kashmir was not mapped. For the first time 8 million hectare of unmapped Jammu Kashmir wasteland got mapped. So first time Jammu Kashmir is there in the wasteland atlas. Earlier there was no inclusion of Jammu Kashmir. If you compare 2008-9 with that of 2015-16, whether the wasteland reduced or wasteland increased? When you compare 2005-6 to 15-16, whether the wasteland reduced or wasteland increased? 2005-6, 56 million hectares of wasteland was present in India. 56 million hectares of wasteland was present in India in 2008-9, 56 million hectares. But 2015-16, it became 55 million hectares. So from 56 it became 55. So wasteland reduced. What is the percentage of wasteland in the total geographical area of India? Out of 100% of land of India, how many percentage of land is wasteland? 2008-9 it was 17%. Out of total geographical area, 17% of India is wasteland, 2008-9 data. But we have said that it has reduced in the recent time, 16-17. No, now it is 16.9%. So almost 17%. Out of total geographical area, 17% of land is wasteland in India. And this wasteland atlas is very important. It is fifth version. Who is publishing this atlas? Rural Development Ministry in association with Remote Sensing Center of the Space department. Fifth version, first time 8 million hectares of Jammu Kashmir got mapped, and comparing 2008-9 with that of 15-16, wasteland started reducing. Earlier 56 million hectares, now it is only 55, but total area of the total geographical area, 17% of land is wasteland. So that you need to know. Keeledi excavation, so it is dating back to 6th century BC. Whether religion is present, there is no religious scriptures, so no evidence for religion so far. Maybe in future they can find, but so far no religious scriptures are present. And whether big animals are present like elephant, no. Animals related to agriculture is present like ox, remains of the ox, remains of bull, right? So agriculture related activity has happened because agriculture related animals remains are present. Then earthen part is present, because of that you can conclude that those times people were able to, you know, store water. Water storage facility is present. So religion is not there so far. They have not found any evidence for religion. But definitely the earthen pot or the remains of these small animals, speaking about the agriculture which was practiced during those times. Right? So this is related to Keeledi. Elephant bones. Surjit Balla committee recommendation. What do you mean by elephant bond? I have not paid tax. Let us assume I have not paid tax. Now I am disclosing my income to the government. I am disclosing the undisclosed income of the past. Now what the government tells me, 50% of that undisclosed income, you invest in the bond market, which will have a maturity period of 25 years. And that bond will be used only for infrastructure. The money which comes because of the selling of the bond will be used only for infrastructural projects. So this is called as elephant bond, and this bond was the idea, it was the product of the recommendation given by Balla committee. And the money which is collected through the sale of the bond will be invested only in infrastructure. 50% of your undisclosed income you have to invest in this bond, and the maturity period of this bond is 25 years. The maturity period will be 25 years. So, these are some topics which we came across from 1st of November to 15th of November. The list is not exhaustive. The list is only indicative, not exhaustive. We have some other topics also which came between this period of November 1st to November 15th. But we have convened this session for telling you only one thing, that without having a mastery over current affairs, the game becomes really difficult. And secondly, for students who are preparing for this examination, due to the time constraint, they may not be able to consolidate the current affairs. Initially, we have seen because of the initial enthusiasm, people will do something, but in the midway, they will lose interest or they don't have time. They will not be able to manage their time. So we wanted in 1 week, some 4 to 4.5 hours of your time, so that what is important for that week, which came in the paper, will be discussed from the root to the fruit. So this current affairs is not just a product, it is a process. This class is a process. The more and more deeper, the more and more broader you cover the topics, the more and more chance will be there for us to get the questions from those topics, and thereby the probability of our success will be tremendously increased. So here comes the importance of this class. It channelizes your preparation, because if left to the individual discretion, we have seen the preparation will have so many ups and downs. It has to be consistent. Preparation will have to be very consistent, because this examination demands that consistency in the preparation, because consistency is the other name for UPSC. One who consistently prepares for the exam, he or she clears the exam. One who is having so many ups and downs will find it really difficult. So this will be helping you to move forward to realize your dream of becoming IAS by 2021. The class, the regular class, is going to start from next Thursday onwards, right? That is the regular batch. And if you wanted weekend batch, the subsequent next Thursday will be the beginning date for the current affairs regular batch, and next Saturday will be the start of the batch for the weekend batch. So we wanted you to participate in this learning process so that you become what you wanted to become. All the very best. Thank you.